Grace is sufficient for me. Your strength is made perfect when I am weak. All that I cling to, I lay at your feet. Grace is sufficient. Grace is sufficient. Grace is sufficient for me. To see the Lord, promised land, where in all sins, pearly gates, look,
bye. Good evening, and welcome to Hope in the Night. I'm one of your hosts tonight, Miss Patricia, and I have my one of my sisters, Lee Ann. Let me go ahead and add her to this conversation here. She should be coming up a little minute. Wait 1 second. We're not going to use both cameras on Skype tonight because we're having a little bit of problems. Unfortunately, the bandwidth that I have over here in the woods don't work too well, so I'm getting a flash on and off. What is going on here? Skype is buffering big time. Let's give it a moment. Okay, Leanne, is that you?
Yes, ma'am.
All righty. If you see the blue flickering going on and off, that is the Skype. I've got my repent shirt on today, by the way. Here you go. Hint, hint. That Miss Patricia is known by that shirt, but we just want to welcome you to Hope in the Night. This particular program was brought to you by, or introduced to me by my friend Gina Wilson out in Eustis, Florida. I've known that dear sister for a long, long time. I really have. And she sent me a testimony of somebody's. And, you know, I was just thinking, Father, what do you want? What do you want for the last Hope in the Night program? What is your will? Why not testimonies? Why not encouraging people? Why not bring you what's on people's hearts? What the Lord has done for them and through them and in them this past year or years ago. Because I know chains are going to fall. I know people are going to be set free. I know that these words that are going to come forth tonight are going to be used to touch hearts. Let's pray, Leanne. Father God, we just come to you, B'Shem Yeshua, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, Father. Father, we ask that those that are listening, Father, we ask that those that are listening on Simplecast, on Simulcast, with those that are listening on WTVO and on CMV-TV worldwide right now, Father, we ask that the ground of their hearts, the soil of their hearts would be plowed up. Father, that their ears would be unstopped, that their eyes would be opened, Father God, that they would hear the gospel, the good news, Father God, the news of repenting and coming to you, Father, and what you do to help us in that area before and after and during, Father. Father, I ask that you would encourage people by your Holy Spirit, because it's only by your Spirit men's hearts are drawn to you, Father. We're just vessels, Lord. All that's coming on tonight, everything that's being read tonight, we're just vessels, Father God, for your glory. Father, we ask that you would hide us behind Calvary's cross, that nothing would come out of our mouth tonight that would bring shame to you, that nothing would come out of our mouth tonight, Father God, that would not bring glory to you, Father God. And we thank you, Father, for lives being changed. Father, not for a head count that we can add to our role, that 25,000 or whatever joined, you know. No, we don't need that. If we might never even hear about one person. We might never even know what has happened by the word going forth tonight. But you know, Father. And we ask, Father, that whoever would give their life back to you and to you, that you would lead them and guide them by your Holy Spirit and your word so that they can edify that spirit that you're renewing within them. Father, if you can renew and take out this ex-drug addict, drunken ex-whore, I keep it real, I'm Miss Patricia, and you know that, Father. If you can do something in this person's life so that she can be used by you, I know you can do it. Through anyone, Father. There's nothing too hard for you because I was the worst of all sinners. So, Father, we give you glory. We give you honor. And we give you thanks in the precious name of Jesus for what you're going to do tonight. Amen and amen. Thank you, Father. Okay, well, for our first guest, I want to bring on, what I'm going to do is What I'm going to do, Leanne, is I'm going to exit you off of Skype, and I'm going to bring Sarah back on, because I can't have both of yous on my bandwidth. So you go ahead and hang up, or I'll hang you up, hon. And then I'm going to add Sarah to the call, and then I'll bring you back on once Sarah is done with her testimony.
Okay, you want me to hang up, right?
Yes, go ahead and hang up, and I'll bring you back, okay? Okay. Alrighty. Let me go ahead and remove this. Let me go ahead and add Sarah to this call. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord God, for what you are doing tonight. I praise your holy name. Thank you, Lord. Hey, Sarah.
Hello.
Hi, this is my daughter-in-law. You don't have a daughter-in-law, you have a daughter-in-love, okay? At least I do. This is Sarah, my son's wife. And she's got an awesome testimony that the Lord has put on her heart. We also have a song in the sound room to be played. Sarah, I'm going to give you free reign of the mic. You go ahead. When you're done, you let me know when you're done. Just let the Lord use you. I don't care if it's 2 hours. You go ahead and let the Lord use you.
Well, thank you. This is my first time doing this, but God, I just feel like has given me an amazing year. It's definitely not been a highlight of the year for me, but God has done such amazing things through the simpleness and the littleness throughout this past year. It was kind of a trial for me, you know, being a mom and a work in this world and trying to set the good example. And, you know, we started our year with basketball and for my son, and it's hard to watch your child struggle. It's hard to watch your child work hard and just be frustrated and to get sit back and be that encouraging parent, you know, and I really felt like that's how God must feel as our father sometimes, how he must just be like, come on, you're going to get there. Just keep pushing and keep pushing and keep trying. And, you know, he's right there. And I was right there. And I saw, you know, my son succeed in basketball and just through hard work and joy. And, you know, that I really felt in something as simple and as commonplace as that, God can speak to you and teach you about life. And, you know, it's not for everybody. God uses everything for different people. You know, God brought me to a challenge this past year, had ankle surgery. And part of me wanted to have this surgery, needed to have this surgery, but I was terrified in the other part. And I just said, God, I don't know how I'm going to do this. I don't know how my family is going to come through this. God, this is hard. This was hard the first time. It was very traumatic in 2009. I broke 3 very vital bones in my ankle through an accident and had all kinds of metal placed in. And I had to get all that taken out. And that is not an easy thing to go through. So we prayed about it and talked to doctors and prayed some more and decided to go through with it. And then, you know, and I went through the surgery and it was hard and it was painful. And then through the surgery, it brought me to these amazing people that I sing with, who called me out of the blue and said, you know what, we want to take care of you. And they brought food in and really ministered to my family and to me, and through the very common things of, hey, I'm praying for you today, you know, here's a card, here's encouragement. And I feel like that's what God, the body, to do for each other. It is not easy at all in this life at times. Anyone that tells you, oh, I'm just walking from mountaintop to mountaintop, I'm here to tell you they're lying. They are trying to sell you something, because that is not at all what God says in his word. And as I've relayed a lot of things to music, and it's through music that I definitely can always find a song, always bring a song. And that's what I'm definitely excited about. God has just given me this amazing, he woke me up with it the other day. and said, I want you to do this, and would not give me a moment's peace. I'm going to be doing a show in the new year of just encouragement to people.
Yes.
You know, refreshing, uplifting, encouraging, because it is hard out there, guys. You know this. And it's just, I think that we need that as believers. We need to be able to come together and just, if we're going through something hard, definitely be there for each other. And definitely be there for each other as we need it. But when I was going through the trial with the surgery this past year, God just kept bringing me to this classic gospel song, you know, Through the Fire. It's not an easy thing. God didn't promise an amazing mountaintop experience every day. So I definitely want to encourage you with this. There's a lot of other things here tonight that want to come on, and I want to encourage you with this, the song, and just Psalms chapter 46, where God is talking to us about crying out to Him and how He hears us in the midst of our trial. So if you could play the song,
yes.
I'd just leave you with the amazing words, and
we'll
talk to you another time.
Amen. And the program will be starting in January. Sometime we'll let you know. It's going to be on a Thursday night, approximately 9 o'clock. It's called Joy for the Journey. So be listening. It'll be only on WTBO Radio and through CMV-TV. It'll definitely be an encouragement for you. We're going to go to that song. Thank you so much, Sarah. God bless you.
Could not understand. And many times in trials, weakness blurs my vision, and then my frustration gets so out of hand. Oh, but it's then I am reminded I've never been forsaken, and I've never had to stand one day. That's when I look at all the victories, and the spirit rises up in me. And it's through the fire, and my weakness is a master. Oh, He never promised that the cross would not be heavy, and the hill would not. Take you through the fire again. Oh, here's the key to church. I know.
that our Father, He said Him, would always come in time. Just a little bit of standing in the valley of decision, and love of
Okay. All right. I'm learning how to work this thing. We have a 45-second delay, so I'm seeing it playing above the chat room, and you'll probably still see it playing above the chat room, but it is done. And that was a really good song. Thank you so much, Sarah. We do appreciate you, and we're looking forward to that program that's coming out this January. We have a lot of new programs coming up on the radio and on the television right here on WTVO/CMVTV. So we just welcome you here tonight. We welcome Brother Ivan in the chat room. Sarah had to leave. She's got to get up for work in the morning, so she's got to be in bed by 9:30. So thank you so much, Sarah, for that. I'm going to add you, Leanne. We're going to try to do it with the camera for you. We'll see how that works. Wait 1 second. Let me call you. If we're getting any buffering, then what we're going to have to do, I'm calling her right now to get her in on Skype. Pick up the Skype phone, Leanne. What I'm doing is I'm going to try to get her on with camera. If the camera fails, then what I'll do, Leanne, is I'll just tell you to turn the camera off. We'll find out what happens. Turn your camera on. Yeah, go ahead and turn it on. I'm going to add you, because a lot of times what will happen with that camera is it might make us drop, and we don't want to drop.
Is it dropping?
Not yet. Okay, wait 1 second. Let me go ahead and add you. I haven't added.
Oh, maybe my papa.
Okay. 1 second. Beeping and adding people to Skype. And so far, so good. We have so much to do tonight. We really do. So bear with me while I get you on there. You're not live yet, honey. You're not live yet. Wait. Night here isn't the best. We're waiting. Okay. It's Skype. There you go. It should come up in a minute.
Will I see the chat room too? Or no?
Shrink one and open the other. You don't have to look at yourself on Skype. Let's look at the chat room. That's what I'm doing. I'm looking at the chat room. And I believe you're on. I'm not seeing your picture coming up yet. So it's try to bear with us. Thank you so much. We're off too if we're getting too much. Just give it a moment. I'll have with you this. You may have it tonight. Okay, well, it's not showing your camera over here. I'm not showing you.
Yeah.
You might have to go camera off too. I'm going to turn mine off also if you let me. Help me, Lord. Okay, there you go. As soon as you did that, it went back to the picture of Skype. Wait 1 second. Just give us a moment. We thank you. We thank you. We really do. You're listening, all those that are listening out there through simulcasting. You're listening to The Watchman on the Walls, WOTW's Hope in the Night, which is on Tuesday evenings right here on CMB TV. It's not letting me turn my cam off. How about that? Very strange. Not letting me turn it off. Maybe because I turned it on at the very beginning. I'm sorry, sis. Not letting me turn it off. I click on the thing, but it ain't going off. Is everybody hearing us in the chat room? Dr. Pepper on pancakes. How the pancakes. That sounds interesting.
I hear a bunch of people talking in the background.
Well, it might be you don't have your chat room turned off. Turn your chat room off.
That's what it is.
Yep,
that's
little
what
thing.
It is. Let
yep.
me get back.
Go ahead and turn that off. That's okay. And then we're going to get into the program. It's not going to let me turn it off. It just got me on here. So what can I say? Yeah, it's not letting me turn off my camera. So that's okay. We're fine. We're fine. I'm sorry, sis. When Brother Larry is on with us and we use his bandwidth, we can have 100 people on. Put it that way. But on this bandwidth out in the woods, help me, Lord, that we just stay on. You know what I'm saying? Okay. All righty.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. I can hear you fine. Can you hear, I just want to find out, in the chat room there, does everyone hear Leanne? Kelly,
can
Ivan, can you hear? You're not hearing me now?
I can hear you.
Oh, okay, okay. Alrighty. Can you hear Leanne? 1, 2, 3, 4? Check 1, 2, 3. Check 1, 2, 3.
She said, yeah.
Oh, okay. Alrighty. Great.
Hi, guys.
Okay. As long as you can hear. I wish I could turn off my camera, but it's not letting me from this end. It is stuck, but that's okay. That's okay. That's okay. All right. We want to get right to the, I'm going to put this up here because I don't want to look at myself delayed on the camera. I don't want to look at myself at all. So I just scrolled up. I'm looking at the chat room right now. And what I want to do, we just heard from Sarah, my daughter-in-law, my son's wife. She's going to be having a brand new program that's coming on the air with us. It'll be starting in January, and it's called Joy for the Journey. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be on Thursday nights at 9 o'clock right here on WTVO Radio. She's not going to be on TV right away. She wants to be on just on the radio right now, so that's fine. That's fine. I'll simulcast her and everything, and we can get that out there. It's going to be awesome, and we welcome her to the team. We really do. And I think that Leanne is... Huh, don't pick my nose. Am I picking my nose? I'm going like this. I didn't pick my nose. You're funny. I love it. I love it. I love it. Let me go like this. Let me just scratch my nose. Oh, Lord is right. Oh, help us, Lord. I'm watching the 45-second delay. It should be coming up any second. Did I pick my nose? I'm looking at this. I don't care. I'll say it on the air. I didn't think I did. I'm not seeing anything. You're picking on me, Kelly. Not fair. The subtle things we do. Yeah, right? Oh, help us. Okay. Oh, I scratched my nose. I saw it. Okay, there we go. Gold up there. Oh, my. All clear. Very funny. All right. Well, I want to go to, you know, I never got you a copy, and I meant to get you a copy, Leanne. Go to your Facebook page, if I could do this while we're on here. I'll have to close it. Can you open up documents on your computer? Or, you know what?
You know I don't know how to do
okay.
that.
Let's not worry about it then. I'll just go ahead and I'll read the things that were sent to me. That's all. I'll just read them. Okay, let me go ahead and open the document up. Testimonies. Here we go. And I've got a Word document, too, from Edlin over there in Great Britain. Awesome testimony. We're going to start with the next one, though, that's on the list. This whole program was started by my friend... over in Eustace, a friend of mine, Gina Wilson, and this is what she sent me the other day, and she said I have permission to read. Gina, if you and the family are listening, I love you, and the baby shower for Rachel was awesome the other day. That was great, and we look forward to a boy this time. Praise God. Alrighty, this is what Gina sent, and feel free to jump in as the Lord leads, Lee. Okay, so I have a praise report for you to put on the radio. Proof that God still does miracles. JR's grandma lives alone and has a special cat named Bright House. Well, a couple of days ago, Bright House came out of the bushes beside grandma's home, looked at grandma and meowed, and turned around and went back into the bushes, dragging his entire back half. Obviously, he was badly hurt, and Grandma did not see him again for days. JR went to Grandma's and searched everywhere for the Bright House, all through the woods beside Grandma's house. No sign of Bright House anywhere. Well, Grandma was heartbroken, and she cried and asked God not to allow Bright House to suffer, and told me she knew he was able to make Bright House whole again and bring him home to her. The next day, still no sign of Bright House. Well, Grandma woke up this morning and decided to fix herself some breakfast after not eating for a day or so. She went outside and looked at the bushes and said, "Bright House, I miss you." And she went back in and ate breakfast and then came out to pull some weeds in her garden, when the cat always comes next to her when she's pulling the weeds. Well, a few moments passed and Grandma looked up, and there was Bright House right beside her. He was completely unharmed, without a scratch on him, and everyone that knew the story figured Bright House had been hit by a car, went somewhere to die, but God knew otherwise and had other plans for Grandma and Bright House. This is proof that God still is in the miracle-working business. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you so much, Gina, for that. And I know that God works miracles with animals. How about you, sis?
Oh, yeah.
Is there anything that has he ever done a miracle with one of your pets that you can remember?
Well, now that you mention that, you know, we had two poodles that died, got out of the house, and they were run over, and it, like, to have killed me. Uh-huh. And during that same week, my stepson was killed. And I think the miracle that came out of it, that God placed it on my husband immediately to go get me another dog, and he paid it. Well, it's not the price, but he had to pay a lot for this dog. And I think he paid $700 for the chopper we have him now.
Uh-huh.
And he brought him home, and to me, the miracle was that the love that God had placed in my husband for me, because he knew I was hurting so bad.
Oh.
And I just thought that was just precious. And,
yeah.
And now we have five poodles.
Five poodles, you hear that? Well, I remember one time with his name was Freckles. It was just a normal black and white cat. But the Lord knew I loved them. We moved down to Florida with Freckles. And why did I call him Freckles? He's black and white. Well, I don't know why, but I called him Freckles. And I remember his kidneys, a lot of times if you feed animals...
I know, Dr. Klein.
Wait one second. If you feed animals certain dry food, you know, because the dry food, they have all that ground cornmeal, and it's all genetically modified cornmeal. So I don't give my animals that stuff. So if you give them certain things, and if you give them only dry food, it can really mess up their kidneys, especially cats. So I didn't know this back then. Well, his kidneys shut down. I brought him to the vet, and they told me that they were sent out a specimen to the clinic, blah blah blah. They said that he's not going to live. His kidneys have shut down, and he won't probably live through the night, so I can spend some time with him if I'd like. I went in there. Now I was a baby Christian. I just found out God just forgave this drunken ex, a drug addict / bad girl, I'll put it like that right now. And on July 27th, 1985 at 7:30 in the morning. Okay, so I was just totally on fire. I'm the same as I was then, though. I haven't changed. But anyway, so I heard my cat's going to die, and I knew that if God cares about a sparrow that falls to the ground, why wouldn't he care about, you know, us? Go lay down, pup. So what I did was I went in and I prayed and over my cat, and they must have thought I was nuts because I even said, you know, and let this be a sign that you truly are God. Well, they told me, they thought I was nuts. And they told me, oh, we'll call you in the morning and we'll let you know what happened. So I went home and I said, I'll be back to pick up Freckles in the morning. They called me in the morning and their exact words was that the sample came back negative. They don't know what happened, but Freckles was up and running around. There's nothing wrong with him. That cat lived. That was when he was 3 years old. That cat lived to be 13. So, glory to God. He cares about even your animals. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Well, wait one second. Give me one moment. I'm looking for another one over here. I'm looking to see if the other one came through on my Gmail account yet, but so far nothing. I was waiting for one to come through from Stephanie. Has not showed up yet. Okay. Help us, Lord. Okay, I'm back. Thank you, sis. Thank you, Sister Leanne. Praise God.
The sound was going in and out.
No, the puppy was sounding nice and loud.
I'm sorry. They quit.
I hear they laid down. I prayed and I sent you a message and I'm just thankful to the Lord. Okay.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you good. I can hear you good. Okay, well, we want to go to, and I wish that you could read this. If I send this to you on Facebook, would you be able to read it?
Yeah.
Okay, let me go ahead and put this in your Facebook message. Okay, wait one second. Here is your friends. Go ahead and read that for your friend. Wait one second. Is she listening tonight? I hope she's listening. She might be on her... Well, you, just because she's not in the chat room, you know, she might be listening on her smartphone. You know, there's a lot of ways you can listen. She could be on my website. She could be on Facebook. We got so many ways for people to listen. It's not funny. But go ahead. This is from Brandy Nicole Berry, a good friend of Leanne. And this is the testimony that she sent us. Go ahead, sis.
Yeah, she starts out by saying, I'm Brandy Nicole Berry, and she's 32, and she's a wife and a mother of four, and been married for 7 years, going on 8 in March, and has been a true blessing from God. I'm a small town girl in a little town from Beulah, Alabama, born and raised just 10 miles outside of the city called Opelika. That's where I lived at one time. I can honestly say that I'm looking back on life. God has spared my life. Wait a minute, I'm trying to go. Okay, I can honestly say, looking back on life, God has spared my life so many times and covered all that I've done in grace. In 1998, I started dabbling in drugs. I remember that year. It was crack cocaine at that time and leading to other harsh drugs such as meth, along with lots of marijuana. Lots of marijuana. Of course, my poor choosing of men didn't help either. Not saying they were the cause, just wasn't a good influence. And later, learning in life. I'm getting there. Later. Learning in life that they were my main addiction. From 1998 to October 2005, I was living a life on the streets and in and out of crack houses, and not to mention the day I was tied up and guns held to my head until my boyfriend brought the dealers money he owed them.
My.
That was my life, running with dealers and manufacturers of meth. and had my first two children in 2001 and 2004, Caitlin, Joy, and Zachary, but had enough willpower to stop during these, hold on y'all, during these times, another covenant of God's grace. Thank you, Jesus. And in 2005, this destructive life came to a screeching halt, but over due time, after reporting to court again, I gained my children back that my mother took in and then had to turn her back on her own daughter. I'm sorry, y'all. Had to turn her back on her own daughter to stay out of trouble with the judicial system and the Department of Human Resources. Prior to the court date, I lost them. 30 days before that, they gave me this amount of days to clean up, but had the guts to show up knowing I had been up all night, never with a wink of sleep, running with the best of them, getting high. But in my back of my mind, I knew it was a way out. I knew this judge would help me. And after failing the drug test, he sat me in jail, not letting any of my parents touch me. And I couldn't leave until it was with a rehab. And after sitting there 2.5 months, he finally granted, my request of a Christian facility I heard about while being in there, and wrote him asking to go to the place called Hosanna Home. This lady came and got me, and I was settled by January 2nd of 2006. The worst Thanksgiving Christmas of my life. But knowing that this was a temporary transition into a lifetime full of changes and transformation for my babies. I attended Mexico mission trips and was took to my first country concert. Went to Panama for a women's retreat. These days are never forgotten. These are days I found myself come to grips knowing my life was more important than where I once was. After 5 months of being locked up in rehab, I finally was reunited with my babies, and now at the age of 1.5, 4.5, and when I first had seen them, my baby girl Caitlin came running to me with this hurt, joyful cry, an emotion I'll never forget. Not that I ever cared about my babies. That's what drugs will do. Make you not care. All I keep telling myself was this was good. I got it out while they were still young so that I could go on and raise them up the way God intended them to be raised. While I was in Hosanna Home, I prayed and prayed God would send me someone to love me, love my life, live my life with, so that I would not fall into the same man's arms. And when I was released in September 2006, 2 weeks later, I met the love of my life. He just so happened to be my sister's supervisor that she introduced me to, the best gift she could have ever given me. He's been the best thing that's ever happened to me. I laid my whole life story and my past out to him, and he would know, not wanting something I had ever done to get back to him, but he loved me and accepted me for who I was. And his motto was, who cares what happened in the past? Just like the unconditional love of our Heavenly Father, he took Caitlin, Joy, and Zachary in like they were his very own. They are now both calling him daddy, and needless to say, their daddy is still living a life of drugs. And in 2007 and 2008, we had my next two children, Levi and Eli. And I often wondered, could God really work that fast? And he later revealed to me he surely could. And I look back on my life now, and I think I may have missed out on 10.5 months of my children, along with all the years I have gone in mine and sold with drugs, that it was worth it all, and it was well worth a lifetime of transformation for them. And we are now really involved in our local church the bridge, and my daughter sings the youth praise team, and I sing with our praise team as well. And all I can say, God's grace is sufficient. He gets all the glory, and without him, I am nothing. And there's a couple more miracles I wish I could share, but it would take me the rest of the night to type up. I can't tell you how many times God has spared my life, and I will soon be working with a prison ministry, and I can't wait for this door to open fully. Be blessed and know you can do all things through Christ.
Wow. Now that...
You know, that's what...
That's powerful.
God was placing on my heart was about embracing...
Go ahead, sis.
...the time and the hour, mm-hmm. about going out into the field and doing this work. The time is now.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And if you yield your heart to him, he will make what's not right in you right.
That's right.
And he'll make the changes so you can go in. His eyes are roving across his earth to and forth for those hearts. To and from for those hearts that's yielding to him. So he can send laborers out in this field. There's so many people sitting in their recliner with their slippers on and waiting on Jesus. I'm ready to go home. I'm ready to go home for Jesus. Well, you know what? That's lazy. That's not what God is. I hate to stand up in front of God and say, well, Jesus, you finally made it. I'm ready to come to heaven. And you haven't even been out in the field working and doing what he expected you to do. That's what he calls us to do. And that's what this is some of the things that he's brought to me today, really. And the miracles a lot of times are unseen.
Go ahead.
And they come big and small.
Uh-huh. Go ahead, sis.
They really, and we don't need, you know, feathers and oil and gold dust coming from the raining on us from the ceiling. Those are not, you know, miracles. Those are, that's wrong. That's not right. What would you call that?
Sorcery. It's sorcery. It's witchcraft. It's Gnosticism.
Yeah.
It's witchcraft.
That's not miracles. And too many people are looking for signs and wonders. The only miracle that, if all the miracles we ever get, is the perfect miracle is his enduring love and his salvation, his gift of salvation. And if that's all the miracles we ever get, then be content with that. I'm not saying, you know, a lot of people, you know, for years I couldn't hear and I couldn't talk. I remember my family, they dragged me up front and I was a little girl. You know, it's good to get prayed for this, and I'm not talking bad about it, but they would drag me up there every Sunday praying for my ears. And it was a big letdown when nothing would happen, and I didn't understand at that time. But evidently, it's in God's will for me for some reason that I can't hear. Or whatever sickness you may have or whatever. But until he gets ready to give you that miracle, it ain't going to happen till he gets ready to do it.
That's right.
And all you got to do is stand and believe and be content with what you got.
Amen. 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 That's good. That's very good, sis. That's very good. He is all we need. Amen. He is all we need. I'm going to put a song on right now. I'm going to put this song on. We will be right back. Go ahead and mute your mic, sis, on Skype. You know how to mute that mic? I'm going to mute mine, and we'll be right back. Enjoy this song.
Oh, just thought of a good reason. Praise him. Waking me up this morning. For so many on my way. For letting me see the sunshine of a brand new day.
Taking you over the night. somebody remember when he took you over the mountain? Can somebody give him praise for his faithfulness when he saw you through the fiery trial? Hallelujah! Oh God, I'm gonna give him praise. I'm remembering Jesus. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Lord, we bless your name. Why don't you lift your hands and thank you?
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord God. Let's remember the mountains that he brought us through. Let's remember the fiery trials that he brought us through. So much he has brought us through. And let's praise him for that. Father, we give you praise right now for every trial that you brought us through, for every mountain that you helped us to climb over, Father God. Father God, sometimes when it didn't even seem like we were able to even do what you wanted us to do and make it through, Father God. But Father, in your knowledge, in your wisdom, we were able to make it through that trial. In your knowledge, in your wisdom, we were able, Father God, to get through all the mess that a lot of times we allowed ourselves to be in for wrong choices. Father, we praise you. Father, we give you so much thanksgiving, Father. We thank you as this year is coming to an end, Father, for all that you're doing, for all that you've done. Now, Father, we ask that you would show us what we can do for you this coming year. Use us, Father. Here we are, Father. We ask that you would use us. And we thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, in the name of Yeshua, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God. Amen and amen. Amen. I love that song. That was by Karen Wheaton, For Every Mountain. That's a good one. That's a goodie. All right, Leanne, you're back with me.
Okay.
I got you back here. Praise God. I'm going to read Kimmy's. My friend Kimmy Flink, her and Marshall are sisters. I've known them for a long time, and she sent this one to me, Leanne. She sent this. Oh, wait till you see the one that Nelson sent. I got three from him. So we're going to listen to Nelson Baegas. I wish he could come on tonight, but he doesn't have Skype, and I don't think we could get him on with Skype because my computer is acting very crazy tonight, but that's okay. That's okay. Kimmy says, okay, he rescued us from the grave. He restored our marriage, our family, our physical healings. He delivered me from depression and all medicines, turned my ashes into beauty with a refreshed outlook on life. He gave me a heart for others, blessed me with the spiritual gifts to use for his kingdom purposes, speaks to me every day in many different ways through nature. Let's put it this way. What hasn't he done for me, Kimmy says. Not one single thing. Does he give me everything I ask for? No. He has restored our finances, all this yet with trials. He has trained my hands for battle through many a trial. Brokenness and desperation, he has made life anew. He is no respecter of persons. So what he has done for me, he can do for you. Shalom, she says. Thank you, Kim. Is that you? Are you going through struggles tonight? Well, I ain't going to have an altar call and say, come on to Jesus. You hear where I'm going, Leanne? Come on to Jesus. Everything will be fantastic. Everything will be peaches and cream. No. Come to Jesus. Come to Yeshua. And I'll tell you, I came to Jesus on July 27th, 1985 at 7:30 in the morning. Within three weeks, I had a miscarriage. My car was repossessed. We were evicted from our home. All within 3 weeks. Praise God. I went outside. I saw my car got towed away. You know what I did? I started shouting hallelujah because little baby Christian here, you know, I just looked in the Bible and I saw that the enemy can't steal from you, that the Lord will replace it. He knows what you have need of. Not everything you want, but what you have need of. Well, within a day or so, I got a job working for Twin County Driving School. I'll give you a plug there, Pete, over there in Long Island in Port Jefferson. And they let me take a brand new Nissan Sentra home with me. While I was giving driving lessons to this old lady, she had a stick shift car that her husband left her when he passed on. And she said, she doesn't know how to drive a stick shift because I taught her how to drive an automatic. She goes, I want to give you my car. Do you need a car? I see you driving this car. Do you have your own car? I go, no. I go, honestly, ma'am, it got repossessed. She goes, well, I'm going to bless you with this. I go, are you serious? She goes, go get your husband and meet me back here tonight. I picked up Kev from his job with my Twin County driving school car. I was teaching people to drive. I drove to Farmingdale. I picked him up, drove back to Kings Park, went to her house out in East Northport, pulled up in the driveway. She handed me the note that was paid in full, and she handed me the keys. Kev drove the car home. I drove my driving school car home. You can't outbeat God. He knew we needed that car. It wasn't something that we had to have. It wasn't a Mercedes-Benz. It was the Toyota. It was an older Toyota, which got us down here to Florida back in, we moved down here in what, we got saved in 85. We moved down here in 1989. The Lord knew what we needed. And that car went. My goodness, that was a good car. That thing, it lasted about another 5, 6, 7 years. But you see how it works? Don't be discouraged. And God's not a name it and claim it God, okay? Don't be naming and claiming on him. But know that he will bless you with all spiritual blessings. That's what he wants. He wants your heart right before him. He wants you walking with him daily, not just when you have a problem. I could go on and on. I'll mention this thing too. I'm going to mention this. I don't need to mention no names, but the Lord, just about a week ago, my cesspool started backing up in my house. And I called up the guy and I asked him, I go, how much? They told me $275. And I'm like, look, I can give you a little bit now. I don't even know this person from Adam. I go, I can give you a little bit now. I give you more in the middle of January when we get the next check. I go, will that be okay? They said, okay. And here I'm thinking that I was going to borrow from somebody also. And I asked for prayer from a few different people. And I'm not saying who, what, or when, but one of the people that I asked for prayer for blessed me with the money and then some to fix my cesspool. God knows what we have need of. They said, don't you dare borrow from nobody. I want to bless you.
Well, you know, you were talking about blessing somebody and how God will, you know, do things.
Yeah.
The other day, I was mailing a gift card to somebody for the holiday for some glasses. And you know, and I got my debit card and I had to go and get the stamp to mail it. And I didn't have my debit card, and I wanted a cocoa and a bag of chips. Now, this is how simple this is. I had probably 4 quarters, something like that, 5 quarters. I barely had enough to get a Coke and a stamp, but I wanted those hot Cheetos. And this lady comes in by me, and she seen me grab the chips, grab my Coca-Cola, and I had that a handful of quarters, and you know, I looked like I was poor as dirt. You know? And now I make that looking frowned, you know, I was up at the store and at the 7-Eleven, and I looked pitiful. I didn't have enough money. I was so embarrassed. And I said, well, just let me get the stamp and the Coca-Cola. I need the chips. And I really wanted those chips. Uh-huh. And she said, no, I tell you what. She looked at the cash register. She was by me. She said, put all that on my tab. I said, ma'am, really, I have the money. I just don't have my debit card. And I just grabbed my change out of the truck. And if you don't have to do that. And she said, no, let me. She said, do you need that milk back there that you was looking at? I said, no, ma'am, no, ma'am. And she kept on. I said, okay, I'm going to let you pay for my chips and my drink, but I'm paying for the stamp.
Oh, my. You see that? And you were blessing somebody with a gift card. You see that?
Well, because I blessed somebody.
God blessed you. So that's what I'm talking about. You know, there's just so many different things. Like, I could just keep going on and on and on and on and name things. It's, you know, a lot of people, you know, I know some people that will ask for money all the time. They'll be posting it, and then they waste it on things that they really didn't ask for it for. And I don't even want to go there, Leanne. You know what I'm talking about. You know, we don't go cruising when we ask somebody to help us pay for, you know, gas for or let's say a program, and then we go cruising on a vacation. I mean, what, you know, what goes through people's heads? But when we just make our requests known to God. When we make them known to God, He knows what we have need of. You know, right. I needed to flush the toilet. I mean, that was a necessary need. You know, I've had groceries come in all week. I got a gift card in the mail too, Leanne. Amazing.
I know, you told me.
Yeah, it was amazing. And my next door neighbor around the block, she was bringing me turkeys, and I mean, it's just been such a blessing. God has been blessing. This is the month of miracles. I've been looking at that. You know, it's the miracles of the Maccabees, which is Yeshua, okay? He's the light of the world. And that light, that lamp, that was, they had a day's worth of oil, and it stayed lit for 8 days. For 8 days. That's a miracle. And I looked at that, and I shared that on the radio, and it was, all these things started happening. All these things. God's saying to you tonight, who's listening, He's still a God of miracles. He has not changed. But stop going after the miracles. Go after Him. When your heart is right before your God, when you seek Him with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your heart, with all your strength, when you seek Him with everything that's in you, the rest will come. The rest will come. He will see to your needs. You don't have to do anything else. You don't have to scheme. Preachers out there that are scheming, that are making people feel guilty, that are playing thank you for giving to the Lord while they're making their little boo-hoo requests. Come on now. Stop it. Stop it. Are you married to the ministry or are you married to the Lord? If He gave you that ministry, He will see it through. So stop finagling the people. And people, stop being finagled. Run to the Lord. Do like that lady did with Leanne at the store. Help a little old lady or help a young person that doesn't have the money for food. Fill up that gas tank. You see somebody putting $2-3 in a gas tank. That's because they don't have money. Fill up their gas tank. Do things like that.
It might make them good.
Hello? Right?
And you have to be able to receive a blessing, too.
Yeah.
In order for the other person to get a blessing.
I tell you, girl, that was a hard one for me. When I lost my job at Sprint, I was the one blessing everybody. And it was hard for me to turn it around. It was hard for me to allow somebody to bless me. And I used to get all sorts of...
Well, I always heard that you know, and I don't know if it's true or not. You may have to correct me.
Go ahead.
But I grew up with the saying now, you have to learn to receive just like you give, because if you don't receive what the other person that God had told them to bless you with, you're cheating them out of a blessing.
Yes. Yes. That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
My grandma used to say that.
Because what you sow, you're going to reap. So somebody's trying to sow into your life. Don't let them not. Please don't let them not. I mean, my goodness, I remember my heating pad broke one time and some nice, sweet lady sent me a heating pad. I mean, Leanne, I got so many miracles. So many miracles. Why don't you go lay on your heating pad? I would, but it broke the other day. They're like, okay. I mean, I can tell you so many different things, and it's not just that. You know, when I see my children loving the Lord, when I see them have a godly friend, like Darnell is over the house right now, a godly young man just like them. Yeah, they're not hanging out at the bars. They're not getting high. Okay, and he's got a brother. Darnell's got a brother that's out there, and I'm going to spank you next time I see you, Jamal. Let me tell you, I will spank your butt because I know you're doing things that aren't right, and I hope you're listening tonight because you know your brother's over here. But the boys, the three of them, they're in the back room. They're playing video games. You know, they're outside with the camera doing some filming. I'm grateful for that. Kev, he's not feeling very good tonight. Please keep my husband in prayer. Okay, he's still got some problems going on with his nervous system. And we're just going to believe, God, that the Lord will reveal to the doctors what's going on. Or heal him. Whichever one, you know, right now he says he just had to go home. And what you said before about that, sis, that was him right on. He can't just sit there on that couch and just wish to go home. He needs to do something unto the Lord and let the Lord take care of the rest. And I turned that up. I let him hear what you said, because that was exactly from God's lips to his ears, because that's what he says sometimes. And I thank you, Father, for just touching that man and bringing him back to where he was before our daughter died. Put him on fire once again for you, Father God, that you may use him mightily once again. We thank you for all those that are discouraged right now because of sickness, because of hope deferred, which makes the heart sick. Father God, fan the flame in them again. Spirit of the living God, speak to your sons and your daughters and let them know that they're not alone. We just thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, the name above all names. And we praise you, Father. We praise you. I'm going to go to the next one. I'm going to go, I've got a few of them still here. I'm going to read one of Nelson's. Edlin, if you're listening, I'm saving yours for the last. I love you, sis. Nelson has three testimonies to share tonight. And this is Nelson Baega. You can find some of his words from the Lord on the website, on the Watchman on the Wall Ministries
really
website.
Like him.
You'll find him on Facebook also, and you'll find him on both of my websites. Go to my Facebook and you'll see them. One is The Watchman on the Wall with an A-N, thewatchmanonthewall.webs.com, and the other one is at WTVO.com. So I've got different websites, but I have him on there. And he lives in New York City. He lives in Ridgewood, Queens. And let me just read the first one that's here. As some of you well know, this is Nelson. As some of you well know, I'm looking for employment. As some of you may know, I was terminated from my previous employment at Little Flowers Foster Care Agency because of my refusal to take the LGBTQ training. Recently, I received a call from another foster care agency for a possible job interview because of my vast experience in the field of social works, which spans 31 years. I told them about what happened to me in the previous place of employment at Little Flowers. They said they would call me back after she spoke with the director. She called me back and she said that the training is a requirement and that they wanted my answer right there and then. In other words, I would have to submit to the LGBTQ agenda that is being imposed on places of employment. Well, my answer was no. But at the same time, I told them that I'm being denied the right to earn a living because I won't embrace an agenda. They were not all looking at my experience, in which I had plenty of. All they were looking at is if I am willing to submit to the gay agenda. I'd rather say the homosexual agenda. The call ended. Let me say this so all can see and read. The LGBTQ community, known as the gay mafia, don't own me. This is Nelson saying this, so open your ears out there if you're involved in this. They are not going to buy me either. I'm already owned, bought, and paid for by the blood of Jesus. The LGBTQ may own them and the city of New York, but they don't own me. And I'm not going to submit to them or their godless, perverted, and demonic agenda. According to his will, the Almighty God will open doors, and by his will, God will place me at a job site despite the LGBTQ community that got the state and the city of New York shaking at their boots. God is greater than them, and he will prevail. That's the first one from Nelson Baega. I love you, Brother Nelson. I can't wait for you to be able to get back on Skype, so we can somehow, you know, we're going to have a 1-800 number. Sis, I can't wait. That'll be a lot better. Skype takes a toll because it uses a lot of bandwidth to get people on. So I closed my camera and I closed yours, and we're doing fine now. But if we play a song, I got to boot you off and then I get you back on. But we'll have a 1-800 number probably in the springtime, which will be a lot better. That way we could just let you call in from all over the country. All over the world you'll be able to call in. Praise God. All right, I'm going to go to the next one, sis. You have anything you want to jump in on that before I go to the next one?
Not yet. I'm sure I will.
Okay, here's the next one. He says, stand for your faith in Christ Jesus no matter what. He wrote this March 18th, 2014. Believers, I am no longer working at Little Flowers Social Services in New York City. God has allowed me to be taken out of there, which came about by the refusal of taking the LGBTQ training, which would have been a 3 hours of indoctrination from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m., which was held on January 16, 2014. To make it clear, I did not quit because God has placed me in this agency to minister to the lost. It was by His will that I would be taken out by the way of termination. On the day of training, I was approached by another director to ask me why I was not in this training. I told her that homosexuality is an abomination to God, and I will not take part in darkness. I told her if you don't take a stand for faith, then it's good for nothing. The director then said that she's a Christian, and she attends a church that includes everyone. All are welcome. I told her that they have it all wrong. Christianity is an exclusive faith in which fornicators, adulterers, and effeminate will not enter the kingdom. He's bold, sis. I told her that I'm willing to lose my job because God is worthy. On 1/17/14, I came to work as usual, and later on that day, I was called into Human Resources Department just to tell them why I refused to attend the LGBTQ training, and I told them that homosexuality is an abomination to God, and I added that I am willing to stand for my faith because if you don't, then it's good for nothing. He asked me if my religion is telling me to attend the LGBTQ training. I told him, religion is man-made. My obedience comes from God in His word from the Bible. The HR person then said that he's a Christian and that he's well-versed in scriptures. Then I told him, and then you should know the following. And he quotes this by heart, sis. Listen to this, people. Romans 1:26-27. For this cause, God they gave them up to vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving their natural use of women, burned in their lust one towards another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their ever which is meet. Leviticus 18:22. Thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is an abomination. I told him that he should know these two verses. Furthermore, since he said that he is well-versed in scriptures, I mentioned Genesis chapter 19 to him. He was finished with me, and he mentioned in passing that he was studying to be a Catholic priest, but dropped out. I told him that was a wise dropout. They allowed me to work there until 3 p.m., and then they had come into the director's office to tell me I was dismissed. I went to my desk and strongly advised my supervisor to seek somewhere else to work because judgment is coming to this place because they just stick their fingers in God's eye. Let me stop there. When you touch God's people, you are sticking your finger in God's eye because we are the apple of God's eye. That's what that means right there. That is scriptural. She asked me if I was making a terrorist threat. Do you hear this? I told her, no, no, no. I'm not a Muslim. I have faith in God to do my battles for me. Muslims don't have any faith because they feel they have to do battle in the flesh. I left praising God, knowing that He gave me the strength to stand and to stand strong. This came about by prayer and by girding up your loins, not on your own strength. What just happened was all God. Believers, it was not me, all God. Give Him the glory. I'm pausing right there. If you're at a job right now and they're asking you to do things that are contrary to the gospel of Jesus Christ, quit.
That's what I had to do.
That's it. Quit.
Why don't work?
You walk away. You walk away. You want to expound, sis, and then I'll go to the next one.
Oh, yeah, talking to me.
Yeah, go ahead.
When I was at work, you know, I worked in a beauty shop, and down here in Florida, it's different from Alabama because it's kind of like Thelma and Louise. If you ever seen the movie, Steel Magnolias, you know, country beauty shop. We didn't have gay people and lesbians and you know, beauticians are famous for being kind of loud and proud and notorious. But, you know, when I got down here, I done got saved and walking a new way, and I left my life in Alabama and gone. Live my life for the Lord, and I was excited about going to work, and I love doing hair, been doing it for 20 years. Lo and behold, I get up in this beauty shop. We got the lesbians, we got the men dressing like the women, and, you know, people rubbing on your butt and rubbing on, you know, and you know, and I was making good money, and I just looked at my husband. I said, I can't take this.
No.
I can't take it. He didn't understand, and I prayed about it. And I said, you know, Lord, for years I've always been a single mom and had to work. But once I'd like to be at home. And the Lord, I really felt like it. He said, you quit your job and spend your time with me. And I really believe.
Hallelujah.
You know, because of, you know, since then, it's like I've been on for 3 years, I've been on a crash course with God. And then he had me leave the beauty shop because there's so much filth.
Yeah.
With the gay stuff down here.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's for sure.
And you know what? That we haven't had to change in the way we live as far as financially in our lifestyle, neither.
Mm-hmm.
My husband has provided very well for us. So.
Praise the Lord. Praise mm-hmm. the Lord. So you don't have to take down. If you're wondering what you should do in the coming year, seek the Lord. Nelson waited. They dismissed him. Leanne knew God was saying to leave. So we're not telling you what to do. We're telling you to seek God and see what he would have for your particular situation. With me, I stayed at Sprint. I was witnessing the people on the phones. They would call up to get their phone bill fixed. And one guy was going to commit suicide. He wanted to shut his phone off, and the Lord had me ask him certain questions. He broke into tears. He prayed. He repented. He went back home to his wife. I know they listened to some of these calls, but I was making them money, so they kept me there. And one day, they walked me to the door. And with my last breath, I told my Jewish manager, okay, I won't say his last name. He was a Cohen. I'll just say it like that. I was able to witness to him and let him know Messiah has come and a few other things. And with tears rolling down my face, I gave him a hug and I said, if you were the only reason God sent me here to work, it was worth it. I just messaged him the other day. Mm-hmm. I'm going to see on LinkedIn. I'll see if he accepts my request. We'll see what happens there because they closed down. The Maitland office in Florida, they closed down a couple years after I was dismissed from there. And they were trying to say call avoidance, but they weren't able to prove call avoidance, of course, because I had sent all my records home, and it showed in my records that I was out of 600 and something people that worked there, I was always in the top 6 to 8 people for call, you know, for, you know, what they call is taking the calls and resolving the issues and everything like that. So they tried to hold back on my unemployment, but they weren't able to. Praise God. God wins. God wins all the time. But so ask the Lord what he would have you do. We're doing great with time. You know, we have as much time as we need. We're going to go to the next one right now. This is number 3 from Brother Nelson. And he asked me to leave the sister's name out, who this is. But it's one of the people, one of the young ladies that he worked for. This is a miracle right here. So I'm going to say the child's name is blank. I'm just going to say it like that. I'm not going to say her name because I promised. It says, there was a teenager whom I was assigned to at Little Flowers. Her name is blank. Back when she was 19 years old, she was then diagnosed with bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, and prior to being assigned this case, she was hospitalized for psychiatric reasons because she was observed cursing and screaming at an imaginary individual. Of course, they doped her. Wait one second. Let me pull this out. I don't need that working right now. I thought this was charging it. That will just tax on my computer even more. Goodbye. Go off. Come on. Okay. Where was I? Okay. Because she was hospitalized for psychiatric reasons because she observed cursing and screaming at some imaginary individual. Of course, they doped her with all sorts of psychotropic medications, and I came by to pick her up. She looked like some sort of zombie. I was talking about high doses. Now, this girl at the same time smoked weed and will sleep with every Tom, Dick, and Harriet. I like the way he's changed that, Harriet, okay? She was also bisexual. She was loose as anyone can ever be, sis. He's writing this to me. She even told me that while having sex with some guy, she felt her spirit leave her body. I mean, this girl had all sorts of demon spirits in her. During my assignment with her, I preached the gospel unto her when I got the chance. One day, while I was out in the field, I got a call from a director stating that the medications that she was on was having a bad effect on her. She was shaking all over to the point that she could not put on her own clothing. She needed to be hospitalized. Sis, so I put her in the van and went with her. On our way to the hospital, she put her head on my lap because she was frightened and even said that she wanted to die. At that point, I laid hands on her and I prayed in Jesus' name. I remember her asking me, "Are you praying for me?" And I said, "Yes." On that, she was hospitalized just to get her system cleaned out from the medication. Soon after, she was discharged with new medications. And you know what, sis? She stopped taking medications completely. To show you how almighty God is, she stopped taking them but showed no signs of any mental illness anymore. I mean, she was behaving normal. No hearing voices, no stories about her spirit leaving her body, nothing. It's another thing. She was about to turn 21 years old, and I was told to apply for disability before she leaves foster care. So I applied and did all the paperwork for her. She had an appointment with the disability office to determine her eligibility, but she was denied, and you know why? Because she behaved too normal. Her concentration was normal. Her thought patterns was normal. She shows no sign of mental illness whatsoever. How great is my God? She's assigned herself out of foster care, went to live with relatives in Connecticut. And he goes, "Now I'm going to show you her Facebook page." And he showed me the page. Prior to her Facebook page, she had another one called Lady So-and-So, where she displayed all types of perversions and homosexuality. This new one that she has is not the same person, blank, she was when I knew her. And seeing her in person, in her previous Facebook. Now remember, God put it in my heart to preach the gospel to her every chance that I have. You plant the seed and let God do the rest. This is a very good example. Praise God. Hallelujah. People out there that are listening, that are out there in the fields preaching the gospel, you don't think it's in vain. Keep on sowing the seed. Keep on watering the word. Be it on Facebook. We got some good men and women of God on Facebook that are preaching in love, not out of hate, not out of hurt, not out of frustration. They're preaching out of love, sharing the word of God. Don't faint, beloved. Don't you faint. And those of you that might be involved in homosexuality, bestiality, pornography, fornication, adultery, any sexual sin, any drug sin, anything that you're involved with, witchcraft, Satanism, whatever it is, cry out to the Lord. Ask Him to deliver you, and He will. He will so deliver you. He will set you free. You'll be free indeed. I know what I'm talking about. I know what I'm talking about. I'm going to put a song on, sis. I'm going to drop your call so I can put this song on. This song is by Edlin Samarin, and it's called Forever Yahweh. And then we're going to read, sis, her last, the last testimony, which is hers. I saved this one for last. I'm going to drop your call and put this on so we can listen to the song, and then I'll get you back, sis.
I love Yahweh, praise to Yahweh, whose laws and commands frame the earth. The heavens declare the times and seasons. Let us celebrate Yahweh forever, Yahweh. The days are coming. Watchmen cry, let's go up to Zion, the God of Jacob, who teaches ways, the Logos born from
Jerusalem, take the cup.
Amen. Amen. Let me add you again. They're probably listening to you through my speaker. Wait, I don't want that. I want to add a Skype video. Okay, getting you back on here. I know you can hear her.
Yes, ma'am.
So everyone's listening right now, but I'm still getting you on. So you're on the system here. You're added to. Okay, all right. We are back. We are back. We are back. That song is an awesome song. That's by Edlyn Samorin. And she's from the UK, and she sent me this document. I'm going to pull this document up. Let me go ahead and pull this up. My testimony 2014. Can you hear me over there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. In September 2013, I had just began to fully understand what it was God had been teaching and preparing me for. One of the strongest emphases from God at the time was concerning keeping the Sabbath. Beyond that, I was still just listening. On the 5th of September, if I recall correctly, I had a strong, strong impression that I just could not shake. I felt for sure that it was a type of new year for me. I couldn't think why this was happening. So late that evening, I Googled New Year and found out it was Rosh Hashanah. It was the spiritual new year from me, and I studied further into my Hebraic roots. However, God, being the gracious God he is, to the mind that does not reject his teachings, my mind, even until January, was still working according to the Greco-Roman calendar. So this is my testimony for year 2014. At the beginning of 2014, I believe God had said two things. The first was that he would accelerate me in 1 year. Earlier on, I thought that this to have meant acceleration in a certain field or position, but I quickly came to realize he had meant my understanding. The second came as a prophetic word in March. That was month it got crazy, and I was asked to leave my church because of the Sabbath. Anyway, the word was that all that I did in the year 2014 would set me up for the next 25 years of my life, and that by the 31st of December 2014, I would give my testimony. Edlyn, if you're listening to this, I'm blown away, because here I am asking you. I wrote to certain people. If I didn't write to you, don't feel funny, okay? I wrote to certain people I didn't write to, because I know that you're busy with your parents and certain things that are going on in your life, but there was just a handful that God put on my heart to ask. She was one of them, and look at this. The Father said that she would be giving her testimony December 2014, and I'm very blessed that you're giving your testimony here tonight, sis. She's probably in bed by now, because it's about 6 hour difference. It's probably about 3 a.m., 4 a.m. there. But anyway, it says, now listen, ladies and gentlemen. It was right in the midst of believing God for a very personal miracle. I thought that word was my confirmation. By late November, I realized that what I wanted was not going to happen. Gosh, I was so sad, but I could not allow myself to murmur or complain, or more importantly, doubt the truth I had come to discover. Then curiously, Miss Pat sent me a message just several days ago asking me to give my testimony. Wow! So she could share it. I was sad for about a half an hour, saying to myself, is this a joke? I do not have the testimony I was expecting to give, and suddenly I realized what my testimony was. The title of a song woke me up to see just how far I had come. Every mountain, I have so much to thank God for. And that's strange, because I played every mountain just a little while ago. I'm sorry, Edlin, if you're listening, I didn't get a chance to read this prior to the program. I trust you, and I know that what you sent me would be fine, so I'm reading it straight, and I'm blown away by what I'm reading. You were supposed to give your testimony, and I asked you to give your testimony. Oh, this is so good. Father, I thank you for this sister in the UK. Thank you for her, Father. So this is my testimony. God called me out of deception. He's chosen me to receive his truth. He has not hid his face from me. He allowed me to see and to hear that which so many cannot. He gave me his spirit to keep his laws carefully. And he himself had put his Torah on my mind and in my heart, causing me to love them. Me, I'm no saint according to the traditional sense, but a saint according to God for keeping God's commandments and the testimony of Yeshua. For those of you that don't know, that is Jesus in Hebrew. She goes on to say, I have so much to thank God for. He strengthened me and set my face like flint, but my heart remained soft. He showed me the sins of the people and warned me of their cold-heartedness. And I witnessed these things, although I didn't believe it when he said it. He said, come out from the thing called kirk or church. It's Scottish for kirk. Look that up, K-I-R-K-E. You'll be surprised, beloved that's listening, what kirk/church really means. Pre-warned that I may feel alone. He told her that. He reassured me, saying, I am with you. He said, follow me and me alone. He said, his law is sound and a good doctrine. His prophets are true. He revealed to me his salvation plan for the house of Israel and the house of Judah. He told me of the cause of destruction of the earth. Was it the what is the cause, you may ask? The breaking of his eternal laws and commandments. He gave me something, and that's Isaiah 24, 1 through 5. He gave me something like a sheriff's badge to not only keep the law, but to uphold it, to guard it. G-U-A-R-D. He himself gave me these desires. It indeed is a gift, and for his name's sake. This is my testimony. I have so much to thank God for. He gave me eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to trust and obey, even when it's tough, unpopular, and untraditional. This is why he gave us his spirit. This was the promise for our salvation. Ezekiel 36:27, and I will pour my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. Selah. Blessings. Edlin Semovin. Semovin. Praise you, Lord. I hadn't read this ahead of time, and it just completely blows me away that the Father had me pick her as one of the people to share the testimony. And the Lord had told her at the beginning of last year, the beginning of this year, that she would be sharing it this December. Father, be with her, Father. Guide her, Father God. Use her, Father. I know she is called out, Father God, to be a watchman, Father God. I know that call is upon Edlin's heart and her mind and her spirit and her body. Father, I thank you for using her mightily in the UK and through the ends of the earth, Father God, that the music you've given her, I almost called it her music, but it's your music, Father, the music that you've allowed to be placed in her spirit and to come forth from her lips, Father, that it would break shackles and yokes, Father God, of traditionalism and churchiness, Father God, and that it would draw people to you. Father, tonight, Father, so much has gone on, Lord. So much has gone on, and we just praise you, Father. We just thank you, Father, for what you're wanting to do. Sis Leanne, take the mic and let the Lord use you. We're going to be ending whenever you're done, but take your time.
You know, talking about miracles, since that's the topic of miracles, and, you know, like I said, they come big and small and seen and unseen. And I don't really, you know, think that we're ever really deserving of a miracle. And it's just, you know, from the Lord and it's through his grace and mercy that we receive them because he loves us that much. And, you know, if be encouraged to know that he hears and he most certainly will move those mountains and separate those troubled waters for you. and be prayerful and just stand in full knowingly that God is in control. And that's pretty much, you know, that I have to say. I just know that the Lord loves us and that, you know, just to stand in it and know that He's in control.
Amen.
And don't think that He's forgotten.
Amen.
Everything is done in His timing. He's never late. He's never early. He's always just in time. And you know, we don't lean on our understanding. We lean on, you know, through the understanding of the Father. And everything and every situation, that, you know, it's just like with a sickness or a disability. You know, He uses those situations to minister to other people or even to you. And just, you know, praise God that you're saved and that knowing that He's in control.
Amen. Amen. Father, we just thank You for this program tonight. That it was just so You from beginning to end. From the moment that my friend Gina put it on my heart through Your Spirit, through that message she sent me, Father. The time I talked to Leanne and I asked her to help me with it, Father God. Father, I just know. I know, Father God, that all those that we use tonight in prayer, in praying for this program, in giving testimonies for the program, those in front of the scene, those behind the scene, Father God, I just thank You for them. Father, I thank You for CMVTV, for the growth that we've been seeing, for the people that have been contacting the television station itself. It's just been amazing me, those that are contacting us, Father. Father, I ask that Your complete hand would continuously be upon this CMVTV and WTVO radio. As we end this year, Father, we have one more day to go, and I'm not sure what's going on tomorrow night, but I know this is the last hope of the night for 2014. That You would guide and direct all of us, Father, every one of the people that are connected to this program, every one of the people that are connected to this station, Father God, in any way, shape, or form, that Your hand would be upon them, that You would bless them, Father God, with all spiritual blessings. Let's not forget that part of the scripture. That You would speak to them, Father God, direct and guide them. Father, we ask that You would be with Brother Larry Davenport, who You've entrusted with this mission, Father. Provide for him, Father. He has so much he's got to do there, Father God. He's a couple of days behind at his work right now, he told me. There's so much has gone on, Father God. Help him, Father God, catch up. Help him, Father God, just keep it going, Lord God. Give him Your wisdom. Give him the connections that You want him to have, godly connections, Father God. And allow Your gospel to continue to go out to the highways and the byways via this source. And all the sources that are out there that are godly and consecrated unto You, Father. We thank You for the pastors that care, that are obeying Your word, Father God. We thank You for godly pastors and godly preachers and ministers, Father God. Those that fear You and keep Your commandments, Father. Father, we praise You. We thank You, Lord God. And we just ask that You would just be with us as we go into the new year. We praise You, Lord. Sis, I'll talk to you on the other side. I'm going to put on our last song. Thank you so much for co-hosting with me tonight.
Oh, I enjoyed it.
I love you, and I'll talk to you after the program's over. I'm going to drop the call, and we're going to play Return, Return by Teshuvah. We're going to be having a concert sometime next year. They're going to be doing their, we're going to be having our first live concert on CMB TV, and Teshuvah will be our first band that'll be live with us. So I'm going to end this with Return.
Bye,
Return.
Y'all. God bless. Blessings for the new year.
Return.